encourage you to really think about not doing what they teach you in presentation 101. Tell them what you're going to tell them. Then you tell them all those things. And then you finally tell them one more time what you just told them. When you're dealing with an under 10-minute pitch, you do that formula, they'll know you're not that serious. They'll know that you really don't. Especially for a 6-minute presentation. You have to recap everything you just said for 5 minutes in the last minute to conclude. Something's wrong. You haven't done a good enough job in those first 5 minutes. So I suggest in your close, after you've asked, done the ask, whether you're asking for money or resources or people that they may know, introductions to partners, other companies, when you get ready to close, think back to the beginning story. Okay? It's not magic here. So if you start with a nice story about the problem that you now solve with this great team and this great IP that you have, and this is all we need in order to make this $100 million company, and in conclusion, I'd like to leave you with one thought, and that is, you need to go back to the story, not to repeat the story, but maybe in this way. I'll leave you with my favorite way to close an investor pitch. I use what's called, what I call, Columbo close. Remember Peter Falk, dear departed Peter Falk, bumbling detective. He's in 68 languages. If you haven't seen this program, you just haven't watched TV. Okay. So for 57 minutes, he can't solve the crime. In the last minute, he says, by the way, I just have one more question. And that question always cracks the game. The one question that hasn't been asked the whole time. But yet, it's the one that cracks the case. So the metaphor is, or the analogy is, when you close in an investor meeting, you can use what I call the Columbo close. And here's how it works. I'll give you an example of one that just worked last year. It's one of my favorites to share. So there's a company in Dublin, Ireland. They have a device that a veterinarian can use out in the field. It measures 5 or 6 different tests, given a very small amount of blood. So for veterinarians, they go to the horse, they do the blood draw, they put it in this device, it reads out 5 results within minutes. Whereas, as you know, the problem with blood tests is you have to get it back to the lab is closed on Sunday, you don't get the results until Monday, the horse dies. Right? That's the problem. So here's how he closed his investor pitch. He said, ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, I would like to leave you with one thought, and that is, as you leave here today and you drive down our beautiful country roads, you'll see horses standing in the field. And when you see those horses, you'll know that today you'll see the technology that will forever change how veterinarians can care for those horses right where they stand. Thank you very much. So it's a future thought that you're putting into the mind of the listener so that the next time they do whatever it is you want them to do, or whatever it is they do, then they'll think of you. It could be the next time you get in your car, the next time you get on BART, the next time you buckle your seatbelt, the next time you brush your teeth, the next time you turn on TV, the next time you write the next word down on that piece of paper, you'll know, you know, wherever you want them to go, just plant the seed in their mind, close up with that, and you're done. Then you take questions and answers. Fair enough? Which leads us to number 3, because tonight's not all about me, it's really about the presenters, and I want to get to them quickly. So number 3.
Can you share the slides?
Yes, they're all yours. The URL is So this leads us right into the third biggest mistake that people make when they present, and that is not handling questions and answers in a way that continues to build your credibility that you build when you present. Okay? So here's how it worked. Last night I was at Jumpstart Days over at the, another place, and they had 10 speakers. Each speaker had 2 minutes with the microphone. Then they had 4 minutes of questions by a panel of 5 angel investors, followed by 4 more minutes of non-rebuttal feedback, where you just take it. You know, they say, well, you know, next time, you know, you just can't say anything. That 4 minutes of questions and answers is so vital to your success. I just cannot impress enough upon you how the Q&A can sometimes be more important than the pitch. So So if you think you can rehearse a pitch and nail it, and you know, I got this one, no problem, the first question, you can die. They say, well, how do you come up with that market value? You don't even think about it. And you start falling apart because they ask you a question that you didn't even think about, that's a weakness, and now you don't know how to handle that weakness, now you start sweating, and now you're starting to lose all that credibility and everything that you just built during the presentation. So we don't have time today to spend on it, but I encourage all of you, spend a lot of time on your question and answer period. You have more than just you at your company. Role play. Have them ask you the same questions. List out those questions you know you're going to get. Get people to start listening to your pitch. Listen to their questions. Before you go out to pitch to the real people, listen to the questions you get. Write them all down. And start practicing the response to those questions. And most importantly, make sure that the response you give is genuine, it's heartfelt, and it's the first time, or maybe the second time you're giving it. You know how we all have those questions that you've heard 1,000 times? And somebody's about to ask you that question, and halfway through that question, you go, yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. Come on, hurry up. And then they finish asking the question, and then you pounce on them with the answer. And that's not a good thing. It's like that question and answer period is not just to see if you have the answers. It's to see how you answer those questions. The how you answer those questions, your tone of voice, your posture, your face, all says so much during that Q&A. We can all practice and rehearse that pitch. It's a little bit interesting when you think about somebody saying, all right, well, we're done with the pitch, now let's practice the Q&A. What? People always say, what, huh? I say, yeah, let's practice the Q&A, and you will believe me, it's so valuable, you can't imagine. The rehearsal of Q&A will set you apart from other speakers to allow you to really shine as you have in your pitch, right through the Q&A. And then I think we're done. Last click. That is the last click. So that's it, ladies and gentlemen. I'd love to take questions from you tonight, but I really want to turn it over to the companies, and I am just perfect at timing. So thank you very much.